السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us and our offspring. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive every single one of us and grant us from his mercy and correct us wherever we are going wrong. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those whose lives are in actual fact a preparation for the eternal life, and that is the life after death. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters, it is very heartwarming to be in what I was told would be a freezing city of Cape Town. Yet when I came here, I found the sun out, it was shining, and it was quite warm. And in this particular masjid, it is such a warm atmosphere that some of us have actually begun to sweat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and grant us ease and goodness. The youth is definitely a category that we all have to have hope in. There is no other option. We have to have hope in the youth. We are in fact the youth. So much so that sometimes when we have youth programs and we say we are inviting the youth, you find the oldest of the lot coming in, subhanallah, because each one feels he's still young. No one wants to admit that, you know what, I've clocked 60. He says, I'm still young. And you say, uncle, you're looking old. He says, what are you talking about? You know, and they give you the looks. So we'd like to look at it as an opportunity to earn closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, as you and I know, the aggressive marketing of materialism across the globe is such that we find shaitan winning sometimes when it comes to some of the younger generation and sometimes even the older generation. But the mercy of Allah is such that if you were to sin for 60, 70 years and you turn to Allah at the last moment, He will still grant you paradise by His mercy. However, it is important for us to realize that the leaders of tomorrow are those who are perhaps born today. That's important. We cannot keep on being imams even after we've reached our graves. That won't happen. We cannot keep on being people who remain on leadership up to a point where we cannot move anymore, we cannot speak anymore, or we've passed away. We have to hand the baton down to the next generation. We have to. We have no option. You find the imam will lead for 20, 30, 40 years. And after that, there are young imams that come up. And if we do not bring them up, perhaps sometimes they will never ever come up. So the first point I want to start with is for those who are slightly older. Take pride in those who are younger and lead them with lots of mercy, with lots of wisdom. And remember, the mistakes they may have made should never be a point for us to divorce them from the goodness that is lying ahead in their path. It is important for us to help them, to help them to realize their qualities and to develop these beautiful qualities, to help them to realize responsibility and to take it up and to help them move forth and further within the obedience of Allah in a way that tomorrow when the baton is handed down to them, they do a better job than us. And this is why every society and community has different categories and age groups of people. Each one should complement the other. Never look at the other as a threat. A weakness in society is when you see the young coming up, the old feel threatened. That shouldn't be the case. Never feel threatened. In fact, take them in and let them excel. You might die tomorrow morning, and what will happen? There would be no one to take your seat solely because you did not groom anyone and you did not prepare anyone. We were too worried about someone taking our seat away. And in the interim, we did not prepare the new generation to take over society and community and to take over the leadership. I recall a time when people passed away, they phoned one uncle in particular in a certain society. And this uncle was such, every time he called the others, come and learn how to enshroud, how to give the ghusl and the burial and so on. But people were feeling that, you know what, that's not our job. Until one day the uncle passed away. And what happened? The others were forced to take it. They were forced to take it, they had to. Because you and I know it is fardu kifaya to offer a decent burial to the other Muslimin, to enshroud, to give the ghusl, and to bury them, to read the Salatul Janazah and so on. So it was compulsory upon society. People had to get up. What was wrong? Why did we not look forth to that responsibility of society and tell ourselves, tomorrow I will need to fulfill this, let me learn it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. My brothers and sisters, it is important for us to look at the young generation and to look at them with the eye of hope, bearing in mind that everyone will falter, everyone makes mistakes. It is up to us to guide them out of their mistakes and to help them. So many people who've been in the clubs and who've been on drugs have come out in such a way that they have become an asset to society. But if we were to just look at their mistakes and we were to sideline them completely because of an error or two or three or ten that they've made in their lives, perhaps we would not be able to achieve the goodness within society that we have from them later on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. Many a time people serve in the correctional institutions or the prisons, as some may call them. And sometimes it is for a little mistake they've made. Sometimes a crime that they committed during their own period of ignorance. When they come out of that particular sentence, or when they have finished their sentence and they return to society, we look at them with such an eye that this person is a criminal forever. Such that they may go back to their criminal behavior solely because we have not accepted them back into society. These are the youth of tomorrow. In fact, the leaders of tomorrow, the youth of today. If they've made a mistake, perhaps their correction has happened whilst they were in the jail sometimes, whilst they were busy serving whatever sentence they were serving. When they come out, we embrace them, give them a new breath of life. Let them feel that, you know what, we too are valid members of society who perhaps might have learnt a little bit more than others. So many are those who have spent time in prisons. When they've come out, they've gone back to the prisons in order to help the other inmates because they know what life is all about down there. And this is why we are taught as Muslimin to go and address and speak to those who are in situations of difficulty, because during those difficulties the heart is softened. They will be closer to Allah. And this is why visiting the sick is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a beautiful teaching of Islam. One of the reasons is the heart is softened. A person sometimes may be losing a bit of hope, sees the opportunity to remind them of the owner of all hope, sees the opportunity to remind them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give them a word of goodness, just tell them that you are with them, and just give them the feeling of identity as part and parcel of the Muslim community and the ummah, and you will find what will happen. Their hearts will soften towards Allah. They will thank Allah, "Oh Allah, you've granted me a family, a huge family, people who might not be related to me by blood, but they are related to me by the shahada. They are related to me by humanity. The mere fact that I am a human being, the mere fact that I am a Muslim. Here are people who've come to visit me, who've come to pray for me, who are thinking of me whilst I am sick." We pause for a moment to ask Allah to grant cure to all those who are sick and ill. And may Allah have mercy upon those who are imprisoned for whatever reason they are there. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us look at them with the correct eye. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them and help us and help our offspring. May Allah grant rahmah to those who've passed away. And may Allah grant paradise to us the day we pass away. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, it is important for us to realize we seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want Him to forgive us, but we have not forgiven members of society or the youth for engaging in something that was not befitting a Muslim. Yet it was our duty to look at them, to guide them, to take their hand, to bring them out of the mess. And that is the challenge you have if you claim to be a leader in society, and if you claim to be a parent who is supposed to be a successful parent. Well, your challenge is when your child does something wrong, or when the youth do something wrong, you will spend, even if it means the rest of your life, trying to correct them in a beautiful, sweet way, in a way that they realize when you've passed away, this man really loved me. I've today developed into a beautiful human being, yet had he not held my hand, I might have been in the dumps. It is important for us to ponder over this. We have a lot of hope in the youth. And remember, like when we say we have hope in the youth, we look at the youth today and sometimes we see youngsters with large earrings and necklaces with huge pumps and boots and people with their shorts or their bottoms halfway down their bottoms. You know, they're called bottoms now, no longer pants. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Halfway down the bottom. And they're walking around. How best can we reach them to make them feel that, listen, my son, tomorrow when I am gone, you need to take the reins. And not just when I am gone, because when I am gone, you will need to take it. You'd better start now and you'd better learn the ropes. And this is why, my beloved youth, now we turn to you. We turn to you by telling you, remember, we have a lot of hope in you. If you have had a life where you've made mistakes, it is about time you learnt that you need to lead tomorrow. You will have children, and your children will perhaps have children by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are not responsible today, what will happen to your children and your offspring? Sometimes your parents may not be passing on the baton in a way they should to you, but it should remind us all that we have masajid, the houses of Allah, the ulama, the good company that we have. Something amazing. We need to change the bad company that we've had in order to become people who are elevated in society. You have a responsibility, my youth, and that responsibility is unto your maker to start with. The responsibility towards the one who's made you in such a way, my brothers and sisters, that if you and I were to die right here and right now, what would be our link with Allah? How would He look at us? With the eyes of mercy or otherwise? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. I'm sure if we were to die right here, right now, in this beautiful house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy will engulf us and overtake us. Ameen. So remember, oh my beloved youth, who might be in the clubs today, who might be on drugs today, we desperately need you. And we need you, and yes, you, we need you. And we will give you the chance, inshallah, to lead us by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But quit your ways, quit your habits. There has to come a day when you realize this responsibility. There has to come a day when you are hard on yourself regarding the bad habits that have overtaken you for so many years. Oh, you who are hooked onto pornography, there has to come a day when you turn that computer off, when you turn those movies off, and you realize it's about time I fulfilled my duty unto Allah, my maker. Imagine if a person were to die whilst going to the prostitutes and so on, and they were to die in that condition. May Allah never ever let us die in a bad condition. Ameen. May Allah grant us a good death in a way that we are obedient to Him. But if a person were to die in a bad condition, only Allah knows what would happen to that person. My beloved youth, those are phases. Those are phases and bouts and little times of evil. If you do not come out of your phase in the timeliest manner, perhaps it will result in regret. Like we always say, a person sometimes, as they are growing in their teenage, they are curious. And they want to see what's going on. They might, that teenage time and that adolescent age might drag them, because of their friends or the environment, to a club. Or it might make them perhaps try out a cigarette, try out a drink. May Allah safeguard us. But this is the reality of society. The peer pressure is such that your friends have driven you to something bad. But remember one thing. Firstly, we ask Allah not even to take our youth in that direction to start with. And secondly, those who have gone in that direction, remember one thing. We still love you. You are a part of our family. You are a part of the ummah. You are a part of humanity at large. We look to you with hope that you will come out of that phase as soon as possible. Because the losers are those who remain in a negative phase such that it results in destruction of everyone. When your mother sees you on drugs, she weeps, she cries to Allah, "Oh Allah, my son, oh Allah, my daughter, I really love this child of mine. Ya Allah, you are testing me. Ya Allah, help my child, cleanse the child." The mother is so desperate because that love is genuine. Even if she says, "Son, I don't want to ever see you again at this house," she actually means, "I don't want to see your bad habit in this house." That's what she means. But if you come back, a person who says, "Mom, I've changed. I apologize for what I've done to you. I've been in a phase. My friends were bad. My company was bad. The marketing of this materialism that I was stuck into was so bad. My mother, I am back. I read 5 salah a day. The last 40 days, I haven't even missed 1 salah. My mother, I repented to Allah. I know I returned to Allah. I'm so sorry for making your life so difficult. I'm so sorry, my beloved mother, for having made you cry and weep just for me. My beloved mother, I promise you never to do anything that will disobey and transgress Allah, against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mother will open her arms and hug you with an embrace that even when you were a baby, you were not given that embrace. My youth, we have hope in you. Give up that bad habit of yours. We want to cry because we love you so much, and yet we hate the bad habit you might have. Quit it and cut it. That's why we are here. It is a time of changing a new leaf in your life, my beloved youth. And we need this because tomorrow, who is going to lead? Ask yourself, the leaders of today, would we do a better job than them, or would we do a worse job than them? Surely, as generations pass, we want to do something better. We want to develop. If we have, for example, a masjid of this size, you, the youth, must be thinking how to expand it and extend it. How can you raise 5 million rands for this masjid? Subhanallah, how will you do it? Make the initiative. Go to the elders. Tell them, here you are. We've raised 1 million rands for you. Subhanallah. This is the youth. This is the responsibility. But today, we only think about ourselves, our own pockets, and our parties. My youth, life is not all about partying every weekend, but it is about parting with the partying, if you know what I mean. Really. Because the partying would actually make you forget that you have a Jannah that you are supposed to be working towards. You have a paradise that you are supposed to be working towards. What happened to that paradise? Did I throw it away on Long Street? Where else did I throw it away? May Allah protect us. That's a long street, really. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. We want the short street into paradise. Therefore, be focused. Remember where you are going. Remember where you are heading. My beloved youth, your first starting point is the warm tear, the tear of regret. That is the starting point. And I know I've addressed so many youth, lovely people, but perhaps they have bad habits. We love them, we don't like their habits, but we will talk. And really, we will approach, we will give you that hope. We want to see the twinkle in your eyes once again. We want to see the sparkle in your face once again. We want to see the shining of your teeth once again. And we really have hope. And we ask Allah from this particular house of His, Ya Allah, guide the youth. Ya Allah, remove them from the bad habits. Ya Allah, you know the aggressive nature, Ya Allah, of the marketing, of the evil that is available, Ya Allah. You safeguard our youth from all that. Ameen. So we want to see you, and we really love you, as I said. But my beloved youth, you need to make the effort. You need to realize your responsibility within you. It cannot continue like this forever. It cannot continue like this forever. If we are on drugs, our children perhaps will be marrying animals. May Allah safeguard us. Really. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Already on the globe, I've come across countries where they have animals that are available for people to engage in sexual misbehavior with them, and they call it okay, it's cool, it's something, it's the latest. May Allah safeguard us. That is where the world is heading with all its aggressive marketing of fitna and the aggressive marketing of evil. What about us? Surely we should aggressively market the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved youth, we have hope in you. We look in your eyes and we think to ourselves, tomorrow you will be leading us with a better recitation than all those of our time. Tomorrow we will have more youth in society who know about Allah, who know about the Messenger, who know the deen, who know the true deen, who will be able to preach it to others after putting it into practice. So if you have dwindled today, never lose hope. Get up. Quit your bad habits. Throw those cigarettes away. Throw whatever drugs you have away. Throw everything away. Change your company. Come to the house of Allah. This is your place. This is your home. You should feel very, very much at home when you enter the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is your maker. The serenity in this house, you will find it nowhere else. And Allah has never rejected anyone who's walked into His home. Your own house back at home where your parents are, sometimes because of the bad habit, the parents do not know how to react to you. And because you continue in that bad habit, you might not be welcome there, not realizing that it's actually your bad habit that's not welcome there. Whereas if you come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are more than welcome. This is the house of Allah. This is why when we start salah, one of the first things we acknowledge is that Allah is most merciful, most forgiving. My beloved youth, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. All praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds. We are acknowledging. Most forgiving, most merciful. Most beneficent, most merciful. We are acknowledging. Owner of the day of judgment. It means, Ya Allah, I'm going to come back to you. So that means quit your bad habits. Cut them out. You're going to go back to Allah. What do you offer Allah? I am sure that if you have quit your bad habits for the sake of Allah, and you come to Allah saying, Ya Allah, I was addicted. I was an addict. Drugs and alcohol, gambling and prostitution, whatever else it was. Ya Allah, I was so hooked onto it, but I quit it just because I knew I had to face you, Ya Allah. I'm quite certain that by the mercy of Allah, He will look at you with even more mercy. Subhanallah. But it's up to us to realize, to regret, to feel that, you know what, enough is enough. I need to stand up. I need to serve my society. It's not all about pinching and stealing and entering this gang and that group which does bad things. Why don't we enter a group that does good things? Why don't we change our lives in a way that we will be able to reach out to other human beings instead of them reaching out to us all the time? When someone helps you and perhaps they give you a rod in order to help you to fish and to earn sustenance, it is up to us, once we catch enough fish and we've made enough money, subhanallah, to be able to purchase a few more rods and reach out to others and teach them once again in a bigger way, so that it would be a sadaqah jariyah. It would be a charity that continues generation upon generation in a way that we can say, you know what? My dad taught me X, Y, and Z, and I am going to teach you from A all the way to Z. Alhamdulillah. May Allah open our doors. But it's up to us. The second step, after you regret, you turn to Allah. You ask Him for forgiveness. And Allah is such, no matter what you have done, He wipes it out. No matter where you've been, He ignores it on condition you've turned back to Him. Oh Allah, I went places, I did things. From a young age, Ya Allah, I usurped the wealth. I did whatever. I was on drugs, alcohol. I was in the clubs. I was gambling. I was the one who used to cause problems. And I did this and that. Ya Allah, I really regret. And I am asking You to forgive me. Change my life, Ya Allah. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik. Oh Allah, who turns the hearts, turn our heart and strengthen it towards the deen, not away from it. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, once we ask Allah's forgiveness, with these conditions, He wipes out the past. We have a new beginning. You can smile. Sometimes when we are engrossed in bad habits, you look in the mirror and you are so depressed, you do not like to see your face. I've spoken to youth who are hooked onto bad habits who tell me, I really don't like this bad habit, but you know what? I'm addicted to it. I hate it. I don't want it. But every time I go back to it, my beloved brother, you need to change your friends. You need to change something in your life. Your routine needs to break. If you have had a certain routine, change it. Add salah into your life and see how it changes your life. Add good friends in your life, see how your life is changed. Because salah is also a starting point. If you commit sin every day, come time for salah, you make your wudu and you fulfill your salah, forgetting about everything. Believe me, a time will come when you won't have time for that sin, because you are so, so much in love with the one who made you. May Allah grant us that love. When we enter Allahu Akbar, we feel so guilty about the bad habits, the bad that we've done. May Allah forgive me for my own sins, and may He forgive us all. May Allah strengthen us. Never let your sin bog you down. That is the devil. Shaitan comes to us and makes us feel, you know what? You did 10 things wrong. And when you were young, this is what happened. And when this person was like this, that's what happened. And shaitan makes us feel, well, now you can never be a leader. You can never come up in society. You'll never be able to please your parents. My brothers and sisters, please Allah. That's what it is. Once you please Allah, your parents will automatically come into the picture. And if they don't, perhaps they too need to please Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with us. So never let shaitan make you feel that, you know what, I've arrived at such a level that I can never ever achieve. Wallahi, there are people at the age of 80 who have started learning the Quran, and in a few years they know what's going on. I'm talking of real life examples. People who've reached the age of 80 and 90, and they are now reading the Quran, yet their entire lives they were perhaps unable to do so in a manner that would be acceptable to them firstly. So this is why, don't lose hope. Start with even a minute a day, 5 minutes a day. Remember Allah. Ask His forgiveness. Turn to Him. Ask yourself, who are these friends of mine? Are they going to take me towards heaven or are they going to take me towards hell? Ask yourself. These are very important questions, because this is reality. People normally say, you know what, this life is real. It's so real. There are so many problems. You people are living in a fantasy. That's not true. That's not true. This life itself is a fantasy, because it is so short term. I always say, the fact that you've turned from 1 year old to 2 years old, and to 3 and 4 and 10 and 20, already proves that one day you have to leave this world. Because if life was eternal, we would not be counting our age. And this is why in Jannah, there will be no age as such. You are at a certain age, you do not age after that. Which means you don't become old, you remain. If I were to meet you 1 billion years into Jannah, what question could I ask you? Would I be able to say how many years have gone by? It's an irrelevant question, because there won't be time. That is what you call eternal. The minute you start counting time, you must know it means I'm going somewhere. This is all temporary. The minute you start counting time, remember, it means I'm going to expire. That's what it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to become the best of people before our date of expiry. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us the day He takes us away. My beloved youth, here we are standing in front of you, pleading with you to realize your responsibility, to regret over whatever bad has happened, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make a dedicated effort to learn, to educate yourself in the most beautiful way. Learn, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open your doors. Learn. Learn for the sake of Allah. Look at the first words of revelation. Iqara. Iqara bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read in the name of your Lord who has created you from a clot of blood. Subhanallah. Read in the name of your Lord who has created you. Say Bismillah in the name of Allah and start reading. Educate yourself. Know things, because your link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what will make you. Your link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what will take you further and is what will give hope to the rest of humanity. You need to pass the baton. Today, we have much hatred in society. We have too much enmity in society. One of the primary reasons is we all think we are the big boss. We don't realize it is Allah who is the ultimate boss. Just like I'm a creature of Allah, so are you. So if I want to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I need to acknowledge He created you. And I need to acknowledge that you too have access to the paradise that I am working towards, in a way that you're going to take away nothing from me if you get to paradise. In fact, if you get there perhaps through my prayer, it will make it easier for me to get there. May Allah grant us all Jannah. My brothers and sisters, here we are. Society is weeping and crying for leadership, for youngsters who can be motivational in society, for youngsters who can contribute to society in a way that we can develop far quicker than what is happening right now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. My brothers and sisters, it's about time we reached out to one another. The bad habits that people have, they need to be worked upon. Every one of us perhaps has a bad habit. Every one of us has been affected perhaps in the past or in the present, or perhaps maybe in the future, may Allah not do that to us, but with bad habits. Bad habits that we have had to work upon. We have had to try hard to remove. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy has helped us. In most cases, we've succeeded. In some cases, we have not succeeded. We are still working hard on some of our bad habits. May Allah strengthen us. And this is why, when you see a person doing wrong, remember, direct your dislike to the action and not the being himself or herself. We do not like your deed, my brother, but you, we have hope in you. And the minute that deed is gone, the bad deed is gone, believe me, the embrace you will have from us will be warmer than it was when you had this bad habit in you. My brother, we have so much hope in you that we pray for you, saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, these are my brothers and sisters. Ya Allah, I am a brother to them, Ya Allah. Help me eradicate my bad habits in a way that you love me, Ya Allah. And help them eradicate their bad habits in a way that we can all live together as one family and we can all be loved by you, Ya Allah. My brothers and sisters, what a powerful message. To be honest, the youth is the future. When the youth are dwindling, we have doom looking us in the eyes. But when we have hope and we see people educating themselves, serving in the deen, serving in the dunya, serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we look and we have hope. Today we have medical professionals. Tomorrow, inshallah, we will have double medical professionals who will come up with something that is so unique that will take medicine to another level altogether. May Allah grant it to us. But in the process, do not let the deen go down two levels. That's the question. And that's the issue. Whilst we are trying to serve everyone and humanity, we forget ourselves and the service to our maker. So this is why, in the same way, we want to progress when it comes to medicine. We need to progress when it comes to the link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask yourself, I used to not read any salah. Today I'm reading at least the farad. Tomorrow I want to add the sunnah as well. And the next day I want to add the nafil as well. And the following day I want to add tahajjud as well. Such that I will be two levels ahead of what I was yesterday, today. But if we don't have a plan, and if we don't have a means of executing the plan, and we don't have this courage within us, and we don't have the strength within us, how will we be able to achieve? So this is why we say, don't lose hope. Aim, and aim very high, and work towards it. Nothing is impossible. Where would you like to be? Would you like to be the imam of this masjid? The reality is, it is not far from you. Even if today you have the worst of habits, if you cut them out, you start learning your Quran, you serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you learn the deen, you start serving the people. In a few years time, perhaps in Ramadan, they will invite you, Shaykh, please come and lead us in salah. Is it impossible? No, wallahi, it's not. The same applies. What would you like to be? You would like to be someone. Start working towards it. But it requires a great effort. And this brings me to one of the most powerful points of tonight. Your energies, my beloved youth, are bubbling and bursting. Do not channel them in the wrong direction. Channel them in the right direction. Use them right now to achieve something, because you are never ever going to be as energetic as you are today. Never. As you grow older, you tend to lose your energy. You become a person who grays. You become a person who starts thinking, you know what? I used to be the strongest at school. What did you do with your strength? Did you convert it into a deed? If you didn't, you wasted it. When I was strong, Allah gave me the strength so that I can convert it into the currency that will be valid when I get to Him in my grave. What is that currency? It is called D-double-E-D. That is what it is called. It is called a deed. So when you convert your free time to a deed, it comes with you and it's converted into the currency you can use on the other side. When you convert your energy into a deed, it comes with you. It becomes the currency that's valid on the other side. When you convert the money that Allah's bestowed you with into a deed, it goes with you the other side. For as long as you have not converted it, you have wasted it. So even if you have millions and billions, but you amass them in your bank account and you stash them away, the day you die, others will be fighting over it, but you took away nothing. But if you convert that wealth by giving it, by reaching out to people, by being humble, all you've done is, from the rand or the US dollar, you convert it into another currency known as my deeds. And when you get to the akhirah, the only currency applicable there, the deed. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us these deeds. So you have energy today, use it to read salah, because a day will come when you won't be able to bend anymore. A day will come when you might not be able to make sajda anymore, because you are now quite old and your back is aching. And perhaps you have a slipped disc here and there. May Allah grant cure to all those with slipped discs. And all those struggling with arthritis and various other diseases and illnesses, may you be cured. We ask from Allah that you be cured and we all be cured. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, this is the energy you have. You have so much energy. If you are going to channel it in the wrong today, yes, you will achieve, but you will only achieve that which will destroy you. Some people use their energies to learn how to dance and to hit and rock the floor such that everyone is in awe, but they don't realize all this energy would have had absolutely no benefit. You'd rather have rocked your musalla, subhanallah. You'd rather have turned into ruku' and you'd rather have come into sujood for the sake of Allah, it would have been better than all the moves you've been making and all the women that you've been encouraging to look at you, that you have this move and that move. Subhanallah, why don't you encourage people to turn towards Allah? Use those energies, because tomorrow you won't be able to dance. You won't be able to dance no more. You won't be able to teach people how to dance no more. And at the same time, you're going to sit back and be thinking to yourself, everyone's abandoned me. Everyone's left me. No one wants to know me anymore. People used to call me the Don and the Mayor and what else. All that were just words, subhanAllah. They mean nothing today. I'm all on my own. But if you have had good deeds, you can smile to yourself and say, Ya Allah, you gave me a life. I tried. Now I leave the rest in your hands. Subhanallah. May Allah help us. So this is why we say, when Allah bestows you with goodness, remember, use that goodness in the right channel. Shaitan will definitely come, because that is the battle. And he makes you think you're so strong. So what you can do right now, you can attack this one, you can harm that one, you can go to that club, you can achieve this and do that, you can start gambling, you can oppress the others, you don't need to speak with respect to your parents and to anyone else, you don't need to even have any character, because you are you. Who can even tackle you? You're having your protein drinks every day, you're pumping weights every day, and you've got these huge bulges on your biceps and triceps and quadriceps, if you want to call them, whatever else there is on your body, and you've developed them such that you've got, you know, a six pack. You notice the ulama got one big pack, mashallah. Alhamdulillah. It's a pack that will take you to paradise by the will of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, hot and cold. May Allah grant us goodness. But we have a six pack. What will happen to that six pack? One day it's going to go. Allah says, Shabun nasha'a fi ibadatillahi ta'ala. The blessed lips of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, VIP treatment for that youth who used his energies within the obedience of Allah when he was young and energetic. May Allah make us that. VIP treatment on the day of judgment. The heat will be felt by everyone. But Allah will say, these youth, please come across. And one will be wondering why. And they'll probably be looking at those youth and saying, we were the ones with the biceps. We were the ones with the six pack and eight pack and 16 pack and how many other packs you want. But what about these guys? How come they've been given free, meaning VIP treatment here today? The truth is, because when they were growing up, you looked down upon them whilst they were in the masajid. Whilst they tried, they could have also gone to the clubs, but they didn't. They could have been on bigger drugs than you, but they didn't. They could have been experts in the evil that you engage in, but they didn't. So the reason why we have a talk of this nature is to say, my beloved brother, it does not need to be you that is the bad one. It does not, really. We can change that, but to change that, you need to weep. You need to cry. You need a turning point, and let it be here and now. Let it be here and now. A turning point such that when we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no looking back. No looking back whatsoever. We are ready to help others. It humbles us. We will promote unity in society. We will look at the problems in our society. And rather than making them worse, we will look for solutions. Because my beloved brothers and sisters, the globe is such today. With advancement in technology, with the high education and the degrees that we've never seen in the past, people are still killing each other, fighting each other. People hate each other. There are enemies such that every society is crumbling because the youth are fighting each other and the oldies have taught them. If that is it, surely we as youth want a breath of fresh air. We want to see people get along. We want to see unity in society. We want to see the people sharing the shahada, love one another. Yes, we will have our differences, and we always say we will definitely have our differences. But we as the youth want a solution, how to be able to work together with our differences. May Allah grant that to us. How to be able to love one another with our differences. It's enough of causing problems and asking for disunity and pointing fingers in a way that sow the seed of hatred. We want to sow the seeds of love. We want to sow the seeds of getting along. We can discuss. We can talk to each other. You learn what I have. I learn what you have. We discuss. We may come to common ground. And even if we do not come to common ground, my brothers and sisters, remember one thing. We have a responsibility unto Allah and a responsibility unto one another that we respect one another and that we actually reach out to one another in a positive way. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, being the Nabi of Allah, 23 years, and still you find his message was completely delivered, yes, but not everyone had turned to Islam. Some turned after he left sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what we need to know is, if Allah wanted in one go, he could have told him, "Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever does not accept your message immediately, you need to actually eradicate them, exterminate them." Is that what it was? No. Whoever does not accept your message right now, inshallah, you just have to deliver the goods. Perhaps from amongst their generations, they will accept the message. Look at what happened in Taif. We hear about it every now and again. When they beat up Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, astaghfirullah, they threw stones at him. Na'udhu billah. They made his blessed blood, the droplets of it, flow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all forgiveness for whatever we may have done or said in the past or in the present. Or may Allah forgive us even for that we know and that which we don't know. My beloved brothers and sisters, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent as a mercy to mankind at large, when he was asked, "Can we crush these people who have harmed you physically?" What did he say? He says, "Don't ever do that. If Allah does not guide them, perhaps from amongst their offspring will be those who are guided." No sooner was that dua made, a few years later, they were guided. Their offspring were guided. They all turned to the deen. With us, we become so impatient. So impatient. "Brother, this man is misguided. Finished. Don't talk to him. Don't greet him. Don't associate with him. Throw him out." Well, how is he going to hear the guidance if that's the case? How is he going to hear you? You believe you have all the guidance. Well, you don't want to talk to him. What kind of guidance is that? Where did you get it from? If you had got it from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you would have realized how to deal with the people. You would have realized to reach out to people in a beautiful way. My brothers and sisters, we need to travel the globe in order to let people know that amongst the Muslims, if we were to fight one another, we are only serving the interests of our common enemy. That's all. We are only serving the interests of a common enemy who is waiting for us to do whatever we have to between us so that we can crumble without his interference at all. May Allah protect us from the devil. May Allah protect us from shaitan. May Allah grant us the ability to project into the future, to look into the future and to think and to be concerned about the plight of the ummah 50 years from today. What will happen? It's about time we all sowed the seeds of goodness, of love, of coming together, the seeds of the ability to live together with a difference, and we will see the result of it 50 years from now. But if you sow the seed of dissent, woe upon you. If you sow the seed of dissent, destruction be upon such a person, because 50 years later there will be a whole forest of trees. Each tree will be causing more and more problems. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why we say, the youth, we have hope in you. We look up to you, really. We want to see you without the bad habits. And not all the youth have bad habits. And sometimes these bad habits, some of the older people who are leaders of today have had even worse habits, but they came out of the faith. So this is why we say, get off the phase as soon as you can. A person who's hooked onto pornography, let me tell you, sometimes it's a phase of inquisitiveness where a person wants to see what's going on. It's readily available on the net. Do you know it damages your mind, your body? It actually releases something. It's worse than the addiction to drugs. It's the addiction to pornography. It does so much of harm. If only you could know it. Perhaps one day we might go into it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. So the quicker we come out of it, the quicker we cut it, the sooner we will be able to contribute towards our own upliftment and the upliftment of society at large. The day we leave, people will weep real tears. Real tears, subhanallah. Not that you go and then everyone says, "Wow, this man is finally gone. Finally gone." That's what some people say. And they cry these crocodile tears. And they weep in a way that sometimes you want to think perhaps they have onions that are stuck in their top pockets. The way they are crying. May Allah safeguard us. But we want real tears where people can actually say, "Oh Allah, forgive this person. They have really contributed to us, to humanity, to society. They have reached out to the widows, the orphans." Your parents will say, "Oh Allah, if they are still alive after your death, Oh Allah, this child of mine was such a blessing, Ya Allah. The best of my children, Ya Allah, grant him Jannah and grant us Jannah for the sabr that we are going through." And if you were a parent and you pass away, your children will comfortably be able to say, "Oh, Ya Allah, this father of mine, this mother of mine, they've taught me so much. They always stood by my side. Ya Allah, help them, bless them, grant them goodness and open their doors." My brothers and sisters, it's about time we got up. It's about time we got up and started serving Allah and started serving Allah's creatures, the community we have. We start the development, visit the sick, visit the ill, go to those homes where people have passed away solely to reach out to them during their days when they were low. So when you are low, people will reach out to you. You don't have to get to a drug just because you are low today. There is an ummah that will reach out to you before the drugs reach out to you. There is an ummah that will come to you, and there is an ummah that will actually assist you in whatever way possible, according to whatever their capacities are. The problem with us, we've become so selfish. We look at the children of the other and we think to ourselves, hey, just as well, those are not my children. You know that guy's kids, they're on drugs, they're like this, they're a bad influence. Well, if the other man's children are a bad influence, it should be your duty to think, your concern, how can I help that child in such a beautiful way that I make him a responsible child? But today we say, stay away from that child. You know what? Bad influence. We agree, the child might be, the child's habits are a bad influence, but what have you done to rectify the problem? Have you ever gone to the child, son, I'd like you to drive me to the masjid, please. You know, one is to say, son, let me take you to the masjid. He might say, I don't want to go. Who are you? But if you say, son, I need a favor from you. I know you will do it for me. Take me to the house of Allah. Take me to the masjid. Just drop me off. He'll drop you off one time. He'll drop you off twice. And one day, he'll say, uncle, let me just come in with you. MashaAllah, we've achieved something. You see? But without the thoughts, without the thinking, you know what beats me? When we want to commit a sin, we plan it like we work for the FBI. Believe me. When we want to plan a sin, it is foolproof, complete, it's there. We've thought it out so well that nobody can actually stop us. Well, obviously Allah can stop us with anything, but we talk about how we plan it. But when we want to achieve something, we become stagnant. We cannot think anymore. We become people who say, I've got no ideas. But convert it into a sin, you'll have the best of ideas. And you'll even smile to yourself, hey, I know how I'm going to do that. I know exactly what I'm going to do. So my brothers and sisters, start utilizing your brains, your minds, your energies, whatever Allah has given you, to actually think up solutions of society and start getting the ball rolling by working towards it. Not only say, I've thought up all the solutions, I know them. No, think up a solution, work towards that, inshallah, by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be able to change society and community in a positive way. You will definitely be able to change society, community, and the globe at large in a beautiful, positive way. The way the mess is continuing today, sometimes we just look and we think to ourselves, where will we be 50 years from now? And one person asked me a question when I said that. When I said, where will we be 50 years from now? He said, will we even be 50 years from now? You see the difference? But the reality is, I have hope and lots of hope. And we are here to instill hope in you and in the youth as well. We have a lot of hope because we will motivate one another. We will love one another. We will reach out to one another. We will be people who try to understand the difference between a deed and the individual who engages in the deed. And we will work very hard on the bad habits of the people, bearing in mind that we do not divorce ourselves from our own children when they engage in bad habits. We will try and continue trying. And if we die trying, at least we would have fulfilled our duty unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they come forth, alhamdulillah, a double reward. If they don't come forth, we are still achieving a good reward because we fulfilled the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here we are. My beloved youth, start off by reaching out to yourself. Reach out to the inner you, because I know for a fact we all have goodness at the bottom of our hearts. We all have a good heart. We all have feelings. We all have some softness at the bottom of the heart. Reach out to yourself. Reach out to that little spot within you that will actually start making you feel how needed you are, not only in your family, not only in society, but the ummah at large needs you. You are a blessed ummati. You are a blessed member of this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't let time pass and remove you from that. Rather, work deeper and further in a way that you can bring others also through to the fold and teach them the goodness and reach out to them. So we say, a bad habit will always bring about a huge burden on the shoulders. The minute you cut it and quit it, it might be difficult initially, but you will feel that that burden has just been removed from your shoulders. And you feel the calmness and the coolness. if you do not come out of your stage of weakness, and if you do not come out of the phase of sin that you might be in, then remember, it might just be too late one day. Today, it's not too late. But one day, it might be too late. So don't keep on saying, I will change tomorrow. My brothers and sisters, I want to end by telling you that we need to change here and now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me to change myself. May I become a better person. And may you all become better people. My beloved youth, we have lots of hope. And we are looking to see a better future, inshallah. Everything around us sometimes seems to be so gloomy. But we do know that if the blink of an eyelid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's assistance comes towards us. If we try to achieve His pleasure, and if we try our best to earn that pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I guarantee you that we will see results not only in our own lives, but society at large. The blossoming of the garden, the seeds we had sown, we will start finding the fruits being eaten by the generations to come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us as happy as ever, and may He grant us a new beginning. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahi bihamdi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.